Hi, everybody. Mr. Al Ibrahimi, please. Mr. Al Ibrahimi, in his briefing today to the Council, identified three important dimensions to the crisis in Syria. He specifically mentioned a domestic circle, a regional circle, and an international one, meaning that the special envoy and the United Nations behind him, the Security Council included, have finally acknowledged what we have been saying for almost 2 years, that there are foreign hands interfering in the domestic affairs of my country, Syria. My distinguished colleague, Ambassador of Russia, has just spoken to you about the inadmissibility of seeing members in the Council objecting even to the issuance of a press statements in plural, because so far six draft press statements were objected by some permanent members in the Council. The six press statements deal mainly speaking with the condemnation of the suicide and terrorist attacks that took place in Syria. The last objection against what happened yesterday in the town of Jaramana in the outskirts of Damascus was done by the delegation of United States, as you know, but before that, France also objected to another draft press statement, and England did the same, and Germany. So here we are not anymore in front of somebody who is hiding behind the non-respect of Security Council commitments with regard to combating terrorism, but also it's a sign that these countries are deeply involved in the terrorist acts in Syria. I would like to take the opportunity here to let you know that yesterday evening the armed groups attacked a convoy of UNDOF on the route to Damascus Airport, an attack that resulted in the wounding of four UNDOF staff. We all know that on the same route to the Damascus International Airport, a couple months ago, 48 Iranian visitors were kidnapped and many other bloody attacks took place. Supplying weapons, providing political protection, hosting meetings of the leaders of the armed groups in some capitals, creating forums against the Syrian government authority, promising to supply sophisticated weapons to the armed groups, as we all saw today in this article in the New York Times. All that is not promising about a serious and positive engagement by some influential members in the Council. To solve the Syrian crisis in accordance with Al-Ibrahimi plan, as well as with the 6 points plan of Mr. Kofi Annan, his predecessor. The Syrian people need a positive engagement by the Council in order to fulfill the consensual approach taken by the international community, which is based, as you know, on the Al-Ibrahimi plan, as well as on the Geneva document adopted by the group of action. This is what we need. The Syrian people do not need further bloodsheds, further terrorist acts, further suicide bombers, and further children and women killed on their way to their wards and their schools. I'm in your hands.
فقرات أهم ما جاء به الإبراهيمي خلال الجلسة وكيف تنظرون إلى هذا التقييم؟
السيد الإبراهيمي أحاط مجلس الأمن اليوم علما بتقييمه لمجريات اتصالاته السياسية التي أجراها على مدى الأشهر الماضية مع القوى الفاعلة بالنسبة للأزمة في سوريا. حدد السيد الإبراهيمي مكامن المسؤولية في هذه الأحداث بثلاث حلقات كما قال. الحلقة الأولى هي الحلقة الداخلية السورية، والحلقة الثانية هي الحلقة الإقليمية، الدول التي تتدخل في الشأن السوري وتساعد المجموعات المسلحة، والحلقة الثالثة هي الحلقة الدولية أسماها الدولية. بمثل هكذا توصيف توصل السيد الإبراهيمي إلى خلاصة مفادها أن ما دأبنا على قوله على مدى أشهر هو صحيح تماما، لأن الحكومة السورية كانت دائما تقول أن هناك أبعاد خارجية للأزمة السورية وهناك أيد خارجية تتدخل في الشأن الداخلي السوري. على كل حال، المسألة اليوم لم تعد مسألة ماذا يريد الإبراهيمي من عدمه. الحكومة السورية تدعم مهمة الإبراهيمي وتتعاون معه لتطبيقها على أرض الواقع، لكن المشكلة اليوم هي أن أعضاء في مجلس الأمن بعضهم دائم العضوية قد اعترض للمرة السادسة على التوالي على مجرد إصدار بيان صحفي يدين العمل الإرهابي الجبان الذي حدث بالأمس في مدينة جرمانة في ضواحي دمشق، والذي أسفر عن مقتل حوالي 54 مدني ضحية من أطفال ونساء ورجال وشيوخ بفعل التفجيرين الانتحاريين اللذين حصلا في تلك المدينة. هذه هي المرة السادسة التي تعترض فيها دول دائمة العضوية في مجلس الأمن على إصدار مجرد بيان صحفي يدين عملا إرهابيا، وهذا يخالف كل قواعد العمل الناظمة لمكافحة الإرهاب داخل مجلس الأمن كما تعرفون. Yes.
Like 109 foreign fighters in Syria, and another letter stating that there were 45 foreign fighters coming from places as distant as Chechnya. Has there been any response to your protests?
Thank you very much for raising this very important question. Indeed, I sent this morning a letter on behalf of my government asking to circulate it as an official document, as an urgent matter, to the members of the council as well as to the membership. The full membership of the United Nations. The letter is about, mainly speaking, asking the Council to react responsibly towards the terrorist acts that took place yesterday in the city, in the town of Jeramana. And it also asks the Council members to fulfill their responsibilities in identifying those who are behind these terrorist acts and to prevent those states, member states, who are providing them with the weapons from doing so, and to hold everybody responsible for what he is doing. The letter has not been yet translated and not yet circulated, but this letter was preceded, as you know, as you mentioned, rightly pointed out, by another letter that I sent a week ago, more than a week, which includes the names of 143 terrorist foreigners killed in Aleppo only. They are Tunisians, Libyans, Saudis, Qataris, Egyptians, Palestinians, Chechens, one from Azerbaijan, one from Pakistan, and they all belong to Al-Qaeda organization. Before that, by coincidence, the letter has not been yet translated and has not been yet circulated for some reasons. But this is a very important letter because also we sent it a CC to the head of the Committee on Combating Terrorism, Al-Qaeda Resolution, who is the ambassador of India, as you know, to take action also with this regard. We receive from time to time letters from this committee related to combating Al-Qaeda terrorism, saying that they deleted the name of this Saudi guy who was on the list, or they added the name of this guy who wasn't there. But when you send them 143 names, they don't take action. Before these two letters, I sent another letter also, indeed, in which I provided the names of dozens of other terrorists, some of them affiliated with Al-Qaeda. No action, no reaction. The most surprising thing was my first letter, in which was accompanied by CDs, confessions by alive prisoners from Al-Qaeda. Confessions on the CDs, no reaction. 26 terrorists, all of them from Arab countries, Tunisian, Libyans, Egyptians, and etc., etc., etc. So here we are really in front of not only double standards, it may be triple standards, or I don't know how many standards. This is something shameful, and if you want to combat terrorism, terrorism has no color, has no religion, has no race. This is what we all agreed upon in the United Nations. It seems that the terrorism that is hitting Syria is halal, and the terrorism which is hitting somewhere else is haram. Halal mean legal, haram meaning illegal. شرف أخي علي.
هل الحكومة السورية باتت مستعدة للدخول في حوار سياسي والتخلي عن الخيار العسكري؟
يعني سؤالك ملغوم. باتت؟ لا، الحكومة السورية كانت منذ البداية مع الحل السياسي، ولذلك قلنا نعم لخطة كوفي عنان، ثم قلنا نعم للمراقبين العرب، ثم قلنا نعم للمراقبين الدوليين الجنرال مود وفريقه، ثم قلنا نعم لبيان جنيف. أنت تعرف أن كل هذه المحطات هي محطات حقيقية في الموقف السوري الرسمي. الطرف الآخر ومن وراءه ومن يحميه هو الذي رفض كل هذه المحطات الهامة. لو انخرطت المعارضة المسلحة، الجماعات المسلحة في تلك المحطات انخراطا إيجابيا منذ البداية، لربما كنا الآن انتهينا من الأزمة ووضعناها وراءنا. أقول لربما، لكن لم يصدر أي مؤشر إيجابي من الأطراف الأخرى يدل على استعدادهم للانخراط في آلية الحوار السياسي السلمي وحل الأزمة حلا سلميا.
على أن وثيقة جنيف ما تصل صالحة، لكن بالنظر إلى الانقسام في مجلس الأمن الدولي وتمسك بعض الدول بالحل العسكري كما يبدو، هل تعتقدون أن وثيقة جنيف ما تزال هي الأساس للعمل، وكيف يمكن تجاوز هذه العقبات التي ترونها في مجلس الأمن؟
هناك مرجعيات واضحة اتفقت عليها الحكومة السورية مع كل من بذل جهودا طيبة لتسوية الأزمة السورية، ووافق عليها مجلس الأمن، ووافق عليها ما يسمى بالمجتمع الدولي. الحكومة السورية طبعا هي ليست ضد وثيقة جنيف، لكن وثيقة جنيف لا يجب أن تحجب أيضا نقاط الست لكوفي عنان و التوافقات الدولية التي حصلت حول آليات التحرك. أعطيك مثلا، كل المبادرات الدولية التي وافقت عليها الحكومة السورية تنص في بندها الأول على وقف العنف، لكن العنف لم يتوقف، لأن كل طرف من الأطراف لديه تفسيره الخاص حول كيفية وقف العنف وماذا هو العنف. بعض الأطراف لا يريد الاعتراف بأن هناك جماعات مسلحة. بقي الأمين العام وأعضاء مجلس الأمن يصرون على عدم وجود جماعات مسلحة لمدة حوالي 6 أشهر، ثم بدأ الحديث عن وجود طرف ثالث اسموه بالطرف الثالث، والآن مؤخرا بدأوا يقولون لا، هناك القاعدة، أنشطة للقاعدة، وهناك إرهابيين أجانب ومرتزقة، وهناك جماعات مسلحة. فكلما تأخرنا في توصيف الواقع كلما تأخر الحل. Yes.
Mr. Brahimi outlined for the Security Council the elements of his plan that for a political solution in Syria, and he said that the elements starts with a transitional governing body and that leads to elections. Mm. Would the Syrian government consider a transitional governing body that does not include President Assad?
I don't think that Mr. Brahimi selected specifically this. This part of his plan. There is a full plan, a whole plan of action that the Syrian government agreed upon. Here I am referring to the Geneva document. The Geneva document is not selective. The Geneva document has established a plan of action which starts with the end of violence, and then we move ahead with the other points. So we need to start, we need to implement with the full implementation of the Geneva document points. And that starts with the end of violence as a priority, item one. Then we move ahead to the other steps. The issue is political right now. If the countries that exert political pressure on the armed groups do not stop their political support, their direct involvement in providing weapons to these armed groups, and refuge and safe haven, and camps and training, if they don't do that, item one of Mr. Al-Ibrahimi plan will not be implemented, and that will affect, negatively speaking, the other steps. Yes.
If you answered this, this proposal to put Patriot missiles of NATO on the Turkish border, some are saying that this would create some kind of a protected zone within Syria. What's your understanding of what these missiles would do? And also, Ambassador Chirkin quoted the U.S. as saying, as to the most recent bombings, that there is not sufficient information to label it a terrorist attack. And I wonder, what do you make of that position of the U.S., if it is their position?
Let me start by the second part of your question. I think the American reaction to what happened yesterday in the town of Jeramana reflects, clearly speaking, that the American administration is protecting those who perpetrated these terrorist acts. Anybody who saw the footage of the explosion, of the two explosions that took place in the town of Jeramana, would have concluded easily that there were scores of innocent people who got killed by these two explosions, these two terrorist suicide bombings. Pretending that they don't have enough information, that means they are dealing with the terrorist activities in Syria selectively. They are hiding and protecting some kind of terrorist acts while singling out some others because they don't fit into their interest. As I said many times, you cannot be a fireman and an arsonist at the same time. We need to see a responsible position taken by Washington with this regard, because after all, you know, terrorism is an activity, a cross-border activity. Terrorists have no country. They have no obedience but to killings and bloodsheds. Once you take the evil of terrorism out of the bottle, you will not be able to bring it back into it. So combating terrorism should be a serious matter for all of us. We urged the American administration, especially after the re-election of Mr. Obama, to reconsider its position in such a way that we see Washington involved more responsibly in combating terrorist acts in my country, Syria. Yes.
You mentioned the New York Times article, which reports that the U.S. may become more involved, and particularly that the U.S. sees the current moment as a turning point. What is your impression of that article, and what do you think will be the overall effect of the article on the situation in your country?
I wouldn't comment on a media report, but I made reference to this article published by the New York Times for the sake of clarity and clarification for your distinguished colleagues. This is a very important article, like other articles actually, which was published by not only the New York Times, but the Washington Post and some Turkish newspapers, German newspapers, French. All of them shed important lights on the fact that the capitals and the governments of these countries, USA, Germany, France, Britain, Turkey, are somehow playing and manipulating the evil by supporting the armed groups in Syria and providing some terrorist groups in Syria or acting in Syria. Most of them are foreigners, by the necessary sophisticated weapons so that they could go ahead with their defiance of the government's authority. This is illegal everywhere that happens. This is described by the Charter as illegal. No foreign government should support any armed groups acting on the land of another country. This is a violation of the Charter. This is a violation of the international commitments related to the combating of terrorism. So we have to be responsible while dealing with the Syrian crisis. How come the American administration would be willing to provide the armed groups acting in Syria with sophisticated weapons, while we are all working in the Council on how to make the mission of Mr. El-Ibrahimi a successful one? Either you want to find out a political settlement, or you say that you are, from the beginning, against Al-Ibrahimi plan. Don't waste the time of this gentleman, and don't waste the time of the members in the Council. So this is a big challenge faced by the Council as well as by the so-called international community. Thank you.